In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, amen. Through the grace of God, we will continue our Bible study. Now, we will study the first half of chapter 22 from the Gospel of St. Matthew. The Gospel of St. Matthew, chapter 22. The main points of the chapter about many are called, but few are chosen, and we will understand the meaning of the word chosen here. Is it dependent on God, so we choose people and we have no choice in our salvation, or it is dependent on us? What does it mean that few are chosen? Also, in this chapter, the Lord answered question regarding paying taxes, resurrection, and the greatest commandment. And at the end of the chapter, the Lord asked the question about the Messiah. How he is the son of David, and in the same time he is the Lord of David. How he is the son of David and the Lord of David. From verse 1 to verse 14, the Lord mentioned to him the parable of the wedding feast. This is actually the third parable directed toward the religious leaders. In chapter 21, the Lord mentioned two parables. The first one is about the wicked vine dressers, and the second one about the two sons. One of them did the commandment or the will of his father, and the other one refused to do the commandment of his father. So in chapter 22, the Lord continues and he mentioned the third parable directed toward the religious leader of Israel. From verse 15 to 22, the Pharisees and the Herodians gathered together, grouped together, in spite of the great difference between the theology and the doctrines of the Pharisees and the Herodians, but we'll see how both of them grouped together to test the Lord Jesus Christ, to tempt him when he asked him question whether he should pay taxes to Caesar or not. Then from verse 23 to 33, we read about Sadducees and an argument against the resurrection of the dead. And the Sadducees did not believe in the resurrection of the dead. Then from 34 to 40, a lawyer. Lawyer doesn't mean attorney here, but those who memorized the law and testified for the law of Moses. So a lawyer asked him about the greatest commandment of the law. Although he is the one who interprets the law, but now he's asking about what is the greatest commandment of the law. And after the Lord silenced all of them with his answers, then the Lord actually asked them a question about the Messiah. How he is the son of David, and how in the same time he is the Lord of David. That's from verse 41 to 46. So let's start from verse 1. And Jesus answered and spoke to them again by parables and said, "The kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who arranged a marriage for his son." So the Lord here, by saying this parable, he wants to emphasize the rejection of the Jews. They rejected him. The Lord did not reject them, but as we read in the Gospel of John chapter 1, he came to his own, But his own refused to accept the lamb. He came to his own, and his own refused to accept him. And then the Lord is predicting about the calling of the Gentiles to the true faith. And in this also parable, there is a hint towards the final judgment of both the Jews and the Gentiles. So, the main design of this parable is to show the Jews that they were all invited to believe in Christ. All of them were invited, many are called, but at the end, few of them believed in Him. Few from the Jews believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. The subject of the parable is about the kingdom of heaven. As we read in verse 1, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who arranged a marriage for his son. And the parable ends in teaching about the divine judgment for both the Jews and also the Gentiles. If we count all the parables in the Gospel of St. Matthew, that started with the word the kingdom of heaven is like, we will find that this is the eighth time that the Lord started a parable by the word the kingdom of heaven is like. The kingdom of heaven is about the church, that's the kingdom of heaven. It's the kingdom that God is establishing here on earth, His kingdom. And the marriage that is mentioned here, as Saint Jean Chrysostom says, is to show that there is nothing sorrowful in the kingdom of God. If you are a member in the kingdom of God, if you believe in Christ and you become a member of the church, then there is nothing sorrowful in the kingdom of God, but all full of greatest spiritual joy. You may tell me how come we Christians suffer persecution and we go through hardships. So how are you saying nothing sorrowful in the kingdom of God? I will answer and say, yes, in spite of all the hardships, tribulations, persecution, but none of these things will take our joy from our heart. We will be joyful in spite of all these circumstances around us. And the Lord promised us, I will see you again, and you will rejoice, and nobody will take your joy away from you. And this is the beauty of the Christian life. Yes, we'll suffer tribulations and hardships, but nothing will take this joy away from our heart. The king here is God the Father, who arranged marriage for his son. The son is Jesus Christ. And in many parables in the Bible, and also in many verses in the Bible, the relationship between Christ and us is the relationship of marriage. He is a bridegroom, and we are his bride. That's why St. Paul, in his letter to the Corinthians, he spoke about how he betrothed us to Christ. So he is the bridegroom, and we are his betrothed. And also in the book of Revelation, we read about the supper of the wedding of Christ, the wedding of the Lamb. So here, the kingdom of heaven is the church, and the king is God the Father, who arranged a marriage for his son, is the son here is Jesus Christ. And I want to explain here that our salvation is not only the choice of the son, but it is also the will of the Father. As we say in our praises, by the will of the Father, and the choice of the Son and the Holy Spirit, He came and saved us. So the pleasure of the Father to save us, it is the pleasure of the Father to save us. And why He arranged the marriage, He arranged the relationship between the church, the believers, and Christ to be a marriage relationship. And sent out His servants to call those who were invited to the wedding. And they were not willing to come. Here we can see how He sent them to a certain group at the beginning. This group was the Jews, Israel. In the first commission, the Lord said to the 12 disciples, "Don't go to the Gentiles. Go only to the lost sheep of Israel." He kept His own at the beginning, but when His own rejected Him, then He sent His apostles to the Gentiles. So here He sent His servant to call those who were invited, Israel, to the wedding, but they were not willing to come. Again, He sent out other servants. So for the second time, He sent again to Israel, saying, "Tell those who are invited, see, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fatted cattle are killed, and all things are ready. Come to the wedding." For the second time, He sent to Israel, but they made light of it, and went their ways, one to his own farm, another to his business, and the rest seized his servant, treated them spitefully, and killed them. It was actually the custom among the ancients for the guests to be invited twice. In the old Jewish tradition, when there was a wedding, they used to send invitation twice. The first invitation that they might prepare themselves. And the second invitation was sent a short time before the banquet that they might be there at the proper time. The servant that He sent for the first time were the prophets in the Old Testament, like Isaiah, like Jeremiah, like Ezekiel, like Daniel, like Moses, Joshua, all the prophets, David, all the prophets of the Old Testament. And the servants who sent for the second time, John the Baptist, and also the disciples, the apostles, whom He sent to the lost sheep of Israel. And the marriage here is Christ's incarnation, because He came as bridegroom to marry us, His bride. The Jews who were invited by Moses and the prophets in the Old Testament, they were instructed to believe that the Messiah would celebrate this happy feast. So all the Jews understood when the Messiah come, He will deliver them, He will liberate them, and He will make a happy feast for them. But in their understanding, this freedom or deliverance is from the Romans and their empire, not from Satan and his kingdom. That's why they were crying to Jesus to restore the kingdom of David. Even the Lord Jesus Christ, as the bridegroom, He called the Jews aloud and said, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest." He said also, "If anyone thirsts, let him come to me and drink." He called them by His actions, not by His words only, but also by His actions. And he informed the invited Jews that the banquet is ready, because Christianity was about to be established, and the way to eternal happiness was laid open to mankind. The banquet here is the sacrifice that he gave us, his own body and his own blood. That's why when he said, my dinner, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen and fatted cattle are killed. This actually is a hint toward his sacrifice on the cross. How he would offer himself as a sacrifice, and then he will leave for us every day on the altar his body and his blood, this banquet that makes us united with him, married to him, one in him, he abides in us, and we abide in him. And the Lord did not send to them a single invitation. He repeatedly invited them. And the Jews were invited first of all, before any other nation, before any other tribe or country, by the Savior himself and by his apostles, when he sent them for the first time, when he told them, go to the lost sheep of Israel, and also in the Old Testament by the prophets. But they refused the invitation, and actually they rejected Christ. And after all was made ready, by the death and the resurrection of Christ, the banquet here, the fat cattle and the oxen, refers to how he would die on the cross and offer himself as a sacrifice and would be raised. So the establishment of the kingdom here by his resurrection, the establishment of the kingdom of God on earth, the church. And they were again invited when the apostles went first to the Jews before going to the Gentiles. So after the Pentecost, the apostles went first to Israel. And the Lord said to them before his ascension, you will be witnesses for me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and then to the end of the earth. For 7 years from the Pentecost, the gospel was preached to the Jews only. But they rejected him. Here the marriage feast, the banquet, refers, as I said, to the doctrines, to the sacraments, especially communion, to the graces and gifts that we receive, with which God feeds and nourishes our souls and makes us united to him by faith in his life and by eternal joy and glory in the life after. And the servants here are the first preachers of the gospel, like the 12 apostles and the 72, who proclaimed the gospel of salvation to the Jews, but they rejected him. So, the Lord is referring in the second time, as I said, to John the Baptist, the 12 disciples, and the 72 apostles. And they started their ministry in Jerusalem. Actually, if you study the book of Acts, you will find the first two chapters about ministry in Jerusalem. Then, from chapter 3 to chapter 7, the ministry in Judea. From chapter 8, the ministry in Samaria. And I want you to see here the chronological order. The Lord told them, you will be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the end of the earth. So chapter 1 and 2, Jerusalem. 3 to 7, Judea. 7 ended by the martyrdom of St. Stephen. 8, Samaria. the ministry of Philip in Samaria, to chapter 13, which actually is the beginning of the three missionary trips of St. Paul, which to the end of the earth. So actually the apostles followed the instruction of the Lord Jesus Christ to be witnesses for him in Jerusalem, then Judea, then Samaria, then to the end of the earth. But the Jews actually rejected the invitation, and they used useless excuses, temporal concern, sensual enjoyment. They used their oxen, lands, wives, marriage as excuses to decline, and thus they disrespected the invitation of God. They neglected this salvation and preferred secular enjoyment to the kingdom of Christ. In verse 6, when he said, "And the rest seized his servant, treated them spitefully, and kept them," this actually refers to how in the Old Testament they tortured and killed the prophets, like what they did with Isaiah, what they did with Jeremiah, what they did with Daniel. And also in the New Testament, actually the first persecution of the Christian was by the hand of Israel, the Jews. So verse 6 looks forward as well as backward. Includes the suffering of the Christian preacher and martyrs in the New Testament, as well as the prophets in the Old Testament. And when you read, actually, when you study the book of Acts, you can learn about the persecution of the apostles and the early church, whether St. Stephen or St. Paul or St. Peter or St. James, how actually they were killed by the hands of the Jews. And this refers to how they were ungrateful to the invitation of God. And this demonstrated their wickedness. From the punishment inflicted on the apostles and the prophets, as St. John Chrysostom says, we learn that no consideration, how specious in any way or to any degree possible it may appear, can prove a legitimate excuse for neglecting our spiritual duties. St. John Chrysostom is saying, in spite of all this persecution, but the apostles never ceased to preach the gospel. We read about St. Paul. They stoned him more than one time. They arrested him, but this never stopped him from preaching. So St. John Chrysostom is saying, regardless of all these persecutions and sufferings, there is no legitimate excuse for us to neglect our spiritual duty to be witnesses for Christ. If this marriage did not happen between Christ and us, what does this mean if there is no marriage between Christ and us, if we rejected the invitation to the marriage? It means eternal separation from God, eternal separation from the glory of God, eternal separation from His power, and of course, this is a fearful outcome. Actually, when the Lord explained how these people rejected the invitation, He gave us three examples in verse 5. The first people, they made light of it. The second group went to their ways, one to his own farm and another to his business. The third group, seized his servant, treated them spitefully, and killed them. And we can reflect about these three groups who rejected the invitation of Christ. And they chose to be be separated from God eternally and to lose their eternal salvation. The first group, they made light of it. This refers to the group who actually don't take God seriously, don't take His commandments seriously. They actually choose the pleasures of life and the enjoyment of the earth here, the world, more than the salvation of their souls. Last Sunday was the last of temptation, and we read about the three temptations of Christ. So those who make light of it are similar to those who choose to eat, to change the stone into bread in order to satisfy their own body, their own lusts, and to choose the pleasures of the world more than the word of God. The second group, one went to his own farm, another to his business. This group refers to those who are busy with their business, the love of the riches. And actually, in the tradition, the second group refers to those who saw the kingdom of the world and all its riches and made the money to be their God. That's why they sacrificed their own salvation in order to gain the money and the riches of the world. It is materialism. The first group referred to hedonism, the love of pleasure, lovers of pleasure. Second group referred to materialism, love of money. The third group who sees the servants treated them spitefully. This reflects the egoism, those actually who are prideful. And this was the third temptation when Satan asked God to Christ to throw himself from the pinnacle of the temple, showing off. And many of us fall into this trap. And because of our ego, because of our pride, we treat others violently, unjustly, unfairly, outrageously. So this refers to egoism. And these are the three main temptations: love of pleasure, love of money, and love of ourselves, our ego, our pride. Materialism, hedonism, and egoism. As St. John said, in the world, it is the lust of the eye, lust of the flesh, and pride of life. Lust of eye is materialism, lust of the flesh is hedonism, and pride of life is egoism. And we can see how the three groups neglected their own salvation, and actually they rejected those who brought for them the gospel of reconciliation and salvation. Verse 7, but when the king heard about it, he was furious, and he sent out his armies, destroyed those murderers, and burned up their city. This actually a reference to the destruction of Jerusalem and destruction of the temple 70 AD by the hand of the Titus, the Roman soldier. So the king destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Jerusalem was burned in 70 AD. This actually refers to the punishment here on earth for those who despised his word and persecuted his servant. And as I said, this actually refers to the destruction of Jerusalem. The Roman armies were chosen to inflict their retribution upon the Jewish nation. St. John Chrysostom said, the Almighty knew full well that they were not worthy, he still sent to them these frequently repeated invitations that they might be left without any excuse. So St. John Chrysostom is saying, although God knew or foreknew that they are unworthy, they will reject his invitation. But in spite of his foreknowledge, he continued to send them invitation after another in order to leave them without any excuse. They were not only less worthy of the marriage, but by their very great persistence, ungratefulness, and wickedness, they were quite unworthy of salvation. So those who reject the gospel as an invitation to believe in Christ show that they are not worthy. And here we find how the apostles first kept themselves within the area of Judea, but the Jews continually sought their destruction. As I told you, 7 years after Pentecost, they were preaching in Jerusalem and Judea. Verse 8, then he said to his servants, the wedding is ready, but those who were invited were not worthy. The Jews were not worthy. Therefore, go into the highways, and as many as you find, invite to the wedding. This verse is about the calling of the Gentiles. As you know, the word Gentiles refers to the un-Jewish people. Un-Jewish people. And we can hear, we can see the same words in verse 9. St. Paul repeated them in Acts chapter 15, verse 46. St. Paul said, it was necessary that the word of God should be spoken to you, to Israel, to the Jewish people first. But since you reject it and judge yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, behold, we turn to the Gentiles. It's exactly the same words. It was necessary for us, the apostles, to preach the word of God to you, the Jews, first. But because you rejected the word of God and counted yourself unworthy, then now we will go to the highways, to the streets, to the lanes, to the Gentiles, to invite them to the wedding. Highways in the Greek text literally means exit or going out, or path or roads. Going out of path or roads. So as if we are exiting the ministry to the Jews, and we exit from this road, the ministry of the Jews, to go to the whole world, to the end of the earth. And this was the beginning of the three missionary trips of St. Paul. So the picture here, as if there is a square or many streets, and which number of small streets enter. So this place, therefore, a place of meeting, because the streets from every direction enter into this square. So it's a place of meeting, where many persons would be seen, and persons of all descriptions, from all nations, from all tribes, from every tongue. In the Gospel of St. Luke, when he mentioned this parable, we read streets and lanes. Not highways, we read it streets and lanes, to point out that people to whom the apostles were sent are as either miserable beggars. Miserable beggars here, not in a materialistic way, but in a spiritual way. They are hungry and thirsty to the grace of God. They are poor. But their poverty is not just a financial poverty, but it poverty to the word of God and to his salvation. So, here the apostles were sent to the Gentiles who were poor spiritually and as if they are sitting by the sides of the lanes asking for the grace of God. God is sending his salvation to every soul that all may believe and be saved. Verse 10, so those servants, the apostles like St. Paul, went out into the highways and gathered together all whom they found, both bad and good, and the wedding hall was filled with guests. Many people who can understand it, like Cornelius. Cornelius was a Gentile, but he was a good person. But what about bad? Why God actually calls the bad? God actually invites the bad not to remain bad, but in order to become good. So he's inviting even the bad that they may be transformed and be good. And actually, something here is strange happened. As we read in verse 11, but when the king came in to see the guests, he saw a man there who did not have on a wedding garment. So apparently, these servants were dressing the people with wedding garments. But this man refused to put on the wedding garment. So he wanted to go into the banquet on his own terms and refused to put on the wedding garment. So the king said to him, friend, how did you come in here without a wedding garment? How you entered here? You should have a wedding garment before entering the banquet. Yes, whether you are good or bad, my servants dressed you in a wedding garment. Why you took this wedding garment off and you entered the banquet here without the wedding garment? And he was speechless. Because there was no excuse for him. He couldn't say your servant did not offer me a wedding garment because he didn't offer him a wedding garment. That's why he did not find anything to say. He was speechless. So, what the wedding garment here refers to? The garment here refers to baptism. In baptism, we take off the old man and we put on the new man. You who are baptized to put on Christ. That's why symbolically the church wants to explain this. Want to see each one of us when we were baptized, you received a wedding garment. That's why they dress the babies or the children or the adult even who are baptized with white garments. To tell them, in baptism, you received the new man, you put on Christ. And then we need actually to keep this white garment clean. Maybe it is difficult to keep it clean. That's why the Lord gave us the sacrament of repentance and confession and the sacrament of communion. Anytime your white garment becomes spotted or defiled, you can make it clean again. You can make it whiter than the snow by repentance, confession, and communion given for us for salvation, remission of sins, and eternal life. That's why we don't have excuse to have our garment defiled. In the book of Revelation, when John the theologian saw people dressed in white garments, he asked, who are those who are walking in white garments? And the answer was not those who never sinned, but the answer was those who washed their garment or whitened their garment in the blood of the Lamb. So regardless how many times our garment comes spotted or defiled, every time in repentance, confession, and communion, our garment will become white again. So the garment of life or the wedding garment is our words to keep this garment white. And this is actually is mentioned here. So nobody presume that just faith alone is sufficient for our salvation. To accept the invitation only was not sufficient to salvation. But by accepting the invitation, he should put on the white garment and keep it white to enter the banquet of the wedding. St. John Chrysostom said, "When therefore we are called by the grace of God, we are clothed with a white garment, to preserve it from every stain, from every grievous sin, depends upon the diligence, like watching and praying of every individual." So St. John Chrysostom is saying this white garment, we need to preserve it white from every stain and every grievous sin through the life of watchfulness, prayer, repentance. Those who think that they can come to the feast, they can enter the kingdom of heaven, they can be in the eternal life on their own terms without a life of faith and works, will be cast out like this man. This man thought that he can enter the wedding banquet with his own clothes, by my own terms, but my own understanding. Many people today, when they come to the commandment of God, they treat it like open buffet. What I mean by this? They pick and choose. Yes, I can keep this commandment, but I reject this commandment. And they make their own gospel, their own commandments. So they come to the kingdom by their own terms. That's why they will be cast out. You cannot come to God on your own terms. The wedding guest here, without the wedding garment, is the person who came, accepted the invitation, but did not care about the bridegroom enough to take the time to present his soul purified through repentance and works of faith. So this man represents every soul who actually did not care about the bridegroom enough to repent and to present his soul purified through repentance and works of faith. And here God called upon him to confess. He gave him opportunity. He told him, "Why you are not wearing the garment?" But he was speechless. Actually, he had opportunity to confess his sins and to put on the garment as long as he lives here on earth. Like when the ministers, the priests, the clergy ask you why you did not repent or why you are not baptized until now. And instead of being speechless, actually you should accept this and repent and return to God. So here, God actually called upon him to confess, but he failed to ask for forgiveness and to repent. That's why at the hour of judgment in the last day, it will be too late for those who failed to cleanse their souls in the sacrament of repentance, confession, and communion, and to put on the white garment of the wedding. So, not having on a wedding garment means not having put off the old man and put on the new man, not being a new creature in Christ, not having put on the the Lord Jesus Christ, and as I said, it refers to baptism. Then actually there is a reference here to the final judgment. Verse 13, then the king said to the servant, bind him hand and foot, take him away, and cast him into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. So this verse actually is reference to the final judgment. The place of wailing and gnashing of teeth in verse 13 is the same place of eternal judgment as in other parables, as we read them in Matthew chapter 13. God the Father sent His Son, Jesus Christ, as our bridegroom. And God the Father has given us all what we need through the sacraments to be dressed in the wedding garment of the divine grace, in order to enter into intimate relationship with Christ our bridegroom. He gives us everything we need as grace. And as I told you, no matter how many times your garment is defiled, you can wash it again and you can make it whiter than snow in repentance and in communion. So there is no excuse here. You cannot say, you know, it's too difficult for me to keep my wife, my garment white. There is no excuse here. Yes, it is not God's desire that anyone should perish. God does not desire the death of a sinner, rather that he returns and lives. God actually has made invitation, and he did everything that we need in order for us to be saved. But at the end, it's our choice. That's why in verse 14, the Lord said, for many are called, but few are chosen. The word few are chosen can raise a question here. Is it God who chooses without our will? So we have no word here, we have no saying here whether to accept the invitation or not. Of course not. This is not the case. But chosen here refers to those who accepted the invitation and complied with the condition to keep their garment white. So, if we accepted the invitation and we kept our garment while we'll be chosen. So it depends on you, not on God. He called many. He called everybody. But not everybody accepted the calling, and not everybody kept the garment white. In the first parable, the chosen refers in the parables in chapter 21. When the father sent his two sons to work, and one accepted work in the vineyard and the other refused. So the chosen are those who went to the vineyard and worked. And in this way, parable, those who arrayed themselves with the wedding garment of holiness. So the choice here, dependent upon us, how we answer the calling of Christ, and how we accept the invitation to be intimate relationship with Him. Verse 15. Then the Pharisees went and plotted how they might entangle Him in His talk. And they sent to Him their disciples with the Herodians, saying, before I discuss the question, let me just say a few words about the Pharisees went and plotted how they might entangle Him in His talk. In chapter 21, the Pharisees themselves asked the Lord Jesus Christ, as He could not actually hold Him or catch Him with one of His words. So now they went and did not come again, but they sent their disciples. Maybe they thought that Jesus would not recognize their disciples. He wouldn't know that these disciples are the disciples of the Pharisees. And actually, they grouped with the Herodians. Although, as I explained, they are of two completely different schools, the Herodians and the Pharisees. So, during the first days of the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ, we had two confrontations with the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders and the Pharisees. And the Lord responded to this confrontation and these challenges by these three parables. The parable of the wicked vine-dressers, the parable of the wedding of the son of the king, and the parable of the two sons that were sent were in the vineyard. And clear here that the Pharisees could not catch the Lord Jesus Christ with a word. They were unable to refute his teaching. That's why the Pharisees withdrew in order to regroup, in order to make a plot to catch the Lord Jesus Christ. And this time, they joined forces with the Herodians. Herodians are supporters of the Roman rulers. They are supporters of Herod the Great and his descendants, his children. That's why they called themselves Herodians. And we can see here the different school. The Pharisees were not enthusiastic with the Roman rule. And as a group, they refused to take the oath of alliance to Rome and to King Herod. They refused to be loyal to King Herod and to the Romans. The Herodians, on the other hand, were Jews who lived in the Greek culture, Jewish people who lived in the Greek culture, who cooperated with and admired the Roman rulers. And they were not faithful to the law of Moses. We have here the Pharisees who are very faithful to the law of Moses and also against the Roman Empire. And we have the Herodians who are loyal to Herod and the Roman Empire and also not faithful to the law of Moses. But although coming from a contradicting schools, they are united for one thing: to challenge the Lord Jesus Christ that they might arrest him or catch him with a word. And you notice also that the same Pharisees that challenged the Lord Jesus Christ earlier did not return, but they sent their disciples this time, assuming that the Lord Jesus Christ actually did not recognize their disciples. And they used a different strategy, as a strategy that they would flatter the Lord Jesus Christ with their words, hoping that he would fall into the trap. And also, it is worthy to remark that they could not trap the Lord Jesus Christ by his actions. That's why now they are seeking to trap him by his words, because they couldn't find any fault in his actions. So the Pharisees here instructed their disciples and the Herodians to speak in friendly manner to the Lord Jesus Christ, that he might put off his guards, and thereby they can trap him, thinking that the Lord Jesus Christ, like other men, could be led away by flattery. But this was hypocrisy. So they came to him, as we read in verse 16, and he said to him, their disciples with the Judeans, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are true." They are trying actually to be friendly with him, to flatter him. "We know," as he called him, "teacher, we know that you are true and teach the way of God in truth." There's actually sitting the speech here for the trap. "Nor do you care about anyone, for you do not regard the person of men." So they call him teacher, "You are true, you teach the way of God in truth, and you don't care about anyone, including Caesar, because you don't regard the person of man." And here is a question, the trap. "Tell us, therefore, what do you think? Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not?" And this question was a very difficult question, because actually it is a lose-lose question. Any answer to this question will be lost. It was asked, why it is difficult? Because this question was asked in the presence of the people who professed to have no other king but God, who are bothered by the Roman occupation, and they were looking for their independence from the Roman Empire. And they perceived Jesus as the Messiah who will deliver them from Caesar. So if he said, "Yes, pay taxes to Caesar," then the people will not follow Jesus Christ anymore. Also, this question is asked in the presence of the Pharisees, some of which actually they are they see that it is unlawful for the people of God to serve a stranger like King Herod, those who worship the idols. So you will not only lose the people, but actually you will be like a transgressor to the word of God, because it is unlawful for the word of God to serve a stranger or people who worship idols. Also, this question is asked in the presence of the Herodians. And as I told you, Herodians are very loyal to Herod. So if he said, "Don't pay taxes to Caesar," then actually this word will be taken to Herod and to King Caesar, and he may cause the arrest of the Lord Jesus Christ. And as I told you, this question, if he said, "Don't pay to Caesar," Caesar will be offended and he will arrest the Lord Jesus Christ. If he said, "Pay," he will be perceived as transgressive to the word of God, and he will lose the people who followed him as the Messiah. If he said, "Don't pay taxes to Caesar," he would be encouraging the people to reject the Roman authority over Judea. And as I said, he could be arrested by the Romans for encouraging revolution. And if he said, "Yes, pay taxes to Caesar," actually, they will destroy, the Pharisees and the Herodians will destroy his influence on the Jewish people, because the Jewish people hated the Romans. And he will be taking a position contrary to the feeling of the majority of the Jewish people who followed him, because they are looking to him as the deliverer, the Messiah who will free them from the Roman. And here we can see the wisdom of the Lord Jesus Christ, how he answered this question in a very wise way. Definitely, because he is God. Verse 18. "But Jesus perceived their wickedness and said, 'Why do you test me, hypocrites?'" So here, the Lord told them, "Don't think that I will be flattered by your words. I know you are wicked, and I know that you are coming to trap me. I don't believe what you said about me. You are a teacher, you are true, you teach the word of God, you don't regard men. You hypocrites, hear our Savior, know their malice, that it was their wish in proposing this question to render him either horrible to the people or suspicious character to the government. That's why he told them, hypocrites, why do you test me? And then even the Lord told them, hypocrites, why do you test me? As if he's telling them, I know your motive, I know your heart, I know the secret of your heart. So if I know the secret of your heart, then I am God. Repent and convert from your wickedness and believe in me that you will be saved. Certainly, if they perceived that he could read their hearts, they must conclude that he is more than human. He is God who came in the flesh. It was actually the Romans' regulation to pay taxes in their own coin. So they don't accept any coin except their own coin when you pay taxes. That's why, verse 19, the Lord told them, show me the tax money. The tax money means they have to pay taxes in the coin of the Roman government. Show me the tax money. So they brought him a denarius. And he said to them, whose image and inscription is this? So they said to him, Caesar's. And he said to them, then render therefore to Caesar the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God's. And here actually, the Lord, when he asked them whose image and inscription, definitely he knew that this image and inscription belonged to Caesar. But he showed them the superiority of his wisdom in making them answer this question. They came to trap him, but now they are trapped in their own answer. Because the conclusion will be drawn from their own answer. So, as if the Lord is telling them, you acknowledge that this coin belongs to Caesar. This is Caesar's coin. That's why the coin that is in your land right now, the currency that you are using right now under the Roman government, you acknowledge that this belongs to Caesar. And you acknowledge that you submitted to Caesar. Therefore, don't be unjust. Render to Caesar the things which you acknowledge to be his. At the same time, don't be wicked, but render to God the things that belong to God. So, if this money belongs to Caesar, give it to Caesar. But your heart, your soul, your affection, your person belongs to God. So give yourself to God and give the money to Caesar. So the civil government under which a man lives and by which he is protected demands his honor and reverence. Give to Caesar what belongs to Caesar. The law of the country should be obeyed. By this answer, Caesar is satisfied. And by this answer also, God is glorified. The money will go to Caesar, but our whole being will go to God. Because he's our creator. God's honor in every respect in this answer is secured. And the people here are edified. One of the most difficult questions that could possibly come before them is answered in such a way to relieve their conscience and direct their conduct. So those who pay taxes will not feel guilty about paying taxes because he told them this money belongs to Caesar. But give your heart and yourself to God. So people here are edified. At the beginning, I said, this question is loss-loss. Whatever answer, it's a loss. But now, in the wisdom of God, we can see how, by this answer, Caesar is satisfied, God is glorified, people are edified. Verse 22, when he had heard these words, they marveled and left him and went their way. They couldn't catch him with a word. That's why they left him. We'll stop here at verse 22. And we saw in these 22 verses the parable of the wedding of the son of the king, and how this parable teaches us to be ready to accept the invitation and to put on the white garment of the wedding. And the question about paying taxes, we also learned how to give what belongs to Caesar to Caesar, and also how to glorify God by rendering ourselves to God completely. Glory be to God forever and ever. Amen.